Yeah, please. Please.
Mr. Sumit, you're from Sikar district.
Yes.
Can you tell us something about Sikar, please?
Yes, yes. Sikar is located in the western, central western part of Rajasthan, and culturally, it is famous for Khatu Shyamji and also for the soldiers which are serving in the, for the nation.
Okay.
Soldiers and then Khatu Shyamji temple.
And what is the demographic profile of your district?
Sir, in terms of education and the sex ratio?
Various characteristics of the population including?
Sir, I'm not very very sure of that. So I have to once again refer to that.
Okay. What are the books you've read recently from the reading books?
Sir, I've just finished the What Can I Give by Mr. Sijan Pal Singh, so which is on the life teachings of Mr. APJ Abdul Kalam. And currently I am referring to a book by Mr. Varun Agrawal, which is regarding the science and technology, India's next. So what is India's stake, what is the India's performance for the future in science and technology.
Okay, so what does the book say?
I'm just on the earlier part, so in that case he is arguing that although we are very good at frugal innovation, but that will not, and that is also necessary, but that will not lead to the achievements for in the era of artificial intelligence and fourth revolution. So we need to invest on the higher R&D sector also.
Do we have the money for that?
Sir, the provisions have been made for the newer technology. For example, the budget previous year allocated 3,000 crores for that. But eventually, the Niti Aayog and the India Vision at 75 has proposed that we should increase our R&D budget from 0.85% to 2%. So, government plans to increase the expenditure in a phased manner. And also, we need to include the alumni and the academicians also to fund the projects.
And which is your all-time favorite book?
Sir, this one only, because this What Can I Give, because it has the teachings of Mr. Kalam, which is very very important for the life also, because it is not only about the administration but how to improve as a person, so how to grow as a person, it teaches me.
And any other self-help books you've read?
Sir, I've read books by on the autobiography of Mr. Paramveer Chakravinath, the Manoj Pandey and Vikram Batra also. So they have also taught me the leadership qualities.
So what are the important leadership qualities you think?
Sir, as a leader, we should have a vision, that it should be clear that what is our vision. Then we should have is quality of integrity, that I will not change when the situations are tough. So in that case, it should be that as a leader, we should win and handle situations with integrity in both the cases. Then as a leader, we should have good bonding and good support with the team, that because there are different qualities for each and every person of the team. So as a leader, we should leverage the qualities of each and every person for the betterment or for the common goal. And then as a leader, we should also try to bring new leaders. So if I'm as a leader, if I'm not present, so then my team members after me can lead the team in the future also when I'm not there. So they can lead the mission.
The way you define integrity, it seems involves a certain degree of inflexibility, that the leader should stick to whatever he's once decided. Is that a good trait for a leader?
Sir, inflexibility, I will not say that it is inflexibility. It is that if you are sure that something, the means are as equally important as the aim also. So the process should be done in a right way only. You cannot achieve success only by molding and in a short term. So the things should be done in a right way also. So this is what I mean by integrity.
And you've read anything in fiction?
No, sir.
Nothing in fiction. All right.
You have done energy engineering.
Yes, sir.
What is energy?
Sir, energy engineering is an interdisciplinary branch whereby we are taught the basics of the electrical energy, mechanical, civil, as well as the on the chemistry physics part. So generally, in terms of energy, it is about the energy policies of India, the energy management, with special focus on the renewable part, renewable energy.
See, you have in India different ministries,
yes, sir,
to handle different forms of energy.
Yes, sir.
Do you think this causes any problem in India, or this is fine?
Sir, many studies, including the NITI report, has acknowledged that due to multiplicity of the ministries, there have been less convergence in the policies. So I feel that there should be more convergence, because there are different forms of energy. For example, there is Ministry of Mines, Ministry of Coal, Ministry of Power, Ministry of New Renewable Energy. So in that case, it is creating some problems. So
I am asking a hypothetical question.
Yes, sir.
Why do you think they are not able to have one ministry for the all energy sectors? There is some,
yes,
see, there is some degree of integration now,
yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Presently, but still it is far from what it ought to
be. Yes, sir.
What do you think would be the problem or reason why they are not able?
Sir, I would say that because and these ministries were not formulated at same time, because at earlier times it was mostly our energy dependence was on coal. So in that case, Ministry of Coal emerged, and that was the main source. And then eventually we shifted to this Ministry of New and Renewable Energy in 1990s, and then also Ministry of Power earlier, because we had to provide access to electricity. We had the electricity, but as Ministry of Power, it was to enhance the energy access. And then after that came Ministry of New and Renewable Energy, so that we needed to shift from conventional and more polluting sources to the more efficient sources. So it is because
but
of the
there could be some other reason why this is not happening. This I appreciate, they have all come up at different
stages.
I mean, this is I am only saying that what you think of it.
Yes, sir.
What you may say may or may not be right. What I may think may or may not be right, but still, what do you think could be one of the reasons why they are not coming
to? Yes, sir. One could be also about the specialization of the field. As a ministry, for example, New and Renewable Energy will specialize R&D and overlook on the renewable part only. So in that case, if different ministries are there, so they can monitor that part of the target more effectively.
What do you think is the future of coal in the energy basket?
Yes, sir.
You have coal,
yes,
is a very, very important area.
Yes, sir. Sir, there are many studies that have been conducted. For example,
and
this.
Do you have the idea of what kind of percentage the coal let's say contributes to the energy basket in India?
Yes, sir. Currently it is 59% also, and there is a vision that is energy 2047.
Okay.
So by that, the estimates is that it will be reduced to 30%. The renewable part will be 70%, and the non-renewable part, including coal, will be 30%.
But India being rich in coal, why do you want to reduce coal as one of the forms of energy in India?
Yes.
Oil is hardly there.
Yes.
Yes.
Sir, because India has its policy about that there is one problem of climate change, and we have acknowledged that we may not be the part of the problem, but we will be the part of solution also.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then we want to reduce the carbon footprints, but if we also if we look that the coal production has also ramifications on the air quality. So in that case, it is also killing many of the people. Lancet report says that 10 lakh people are dying because of poor air quality also. So
okay.
This,
thanks. Sumit, you come from one of the top institutes in the world.
Yes, sir.
So I would like you to address the board on few areas. Demographic dividend, unemployability, disruptive technology, artificial intelligence taking away jobs, and industry 4.0.
Yes, sir. Sir, first is the demographic dividend. So the issue that India is one of the youngest country. Only if we look in terms of the age profile of the country, so that can act as a that can, if provided with adequate inputs in terms of human resource generation, in terms of health, education, and the skill development part, in that case we will be able to leverage our this age youngest workforce population, for the increasing the GDP growth rate also. Many studies have shown that if we can leverage this demographic dividend, in that case we can increase our GDP growth rate by 2 to 3% by 2035. So this is one, but the issue here is that we have to skill train and give enough opportunities for human resource capital development. So this is about the human demographic dividend. Second is the unemployability. So the issue here is in India is that since we know that 10 lakh people are coming every month for the jobs in the work profile. So, and we do not have adequate jobs for that much amount of people in public sector. So that is why there is mismatch in the demand and supply. So in that case, the unemployability is high. So for that, we need to ensure that we somehow create mechanisms and processes whereby self-employment and new startups and entrepreneurship at the level of villages and the cities can come up. In that case, Skill India and startup entrepreneurship programs can help. And then third is regarding disruptive technologies. So that disruptive technologies will be about some new technologies which are coming up, and then they are called disruptive because they will change the processes how the current processes are working. For example, sir, for a simple example would be suppose a nanotechnology. So currently we see nanotechnology is something very high, but it can be used for a simple purpose of cleaning drinking water. So IIT Jodhpur has come up with a project whereby they made nano filters for purification of water in Rajasthan. So that has also disrupted the process, and which can be used for different purposes also. So disruptive does not mean only hi-fi technologies, it can be very simple things to disrupt the normal functioning to improve the life of the people also. This is one. Then fourth is industrial revolution. And one was artificial intelligence, and fifth one I missed. Can you repeat that?
Industry 4.2.
So artificial intelligence is about that. Suppose as a humans we are thinking. So if we can train the machines to think like human, they can make decisions out of processing the information which is available on the internet. So that can help to automate the systems and to bypass the processes which humans.
So my question is, artificial intelligence taking away jobs?
Yes, sir.
I don't want to know the technology.
Yes, sir.
What is your thought on it taking away jobs?
Sir, there are two perspectives to it. One is that if we do not skill training, or we do not change the processes, if we do not adopt to the new technologies, in that case, many studies by World Bank show that 69% of the jobs in India will be lost to automation. But the issue here is that earlier processes, the new industrial revolution when internet came and the machines came, at that point of time also there was same type of risk. But eventually it is how we transform and how we skill train our population to that. So because of new technology, AI, new kind of jobs will be also emerging. So many studies and many scholars in artificial intelligence, and I've seen many tech talks regarding the same. So they also argued that new jobs will be created. So in that case, we have to leverage our population to use that jobs also. So it is also about how we shift from the current skill training to the newer level in artificial intelligence. In that case, we can also leverage and bring the knowledge economy to it.
Okay.
So, you have a quite good academic record also.
Yes, sir.
Then why civil services?
Okay, sir. Sir, it was because that as a civil servant, I have given the opportunity to serve many, many people in different dimensions, because I have seen that many people face very hardships. They're not very much empowered. Their human dignity is at stake. So, that keeps me the motivation so that I can improve their lives.
IITs have invested a lot in
your
education.
Yes,
what about that?
Sir, it is seen that because that investment has been, I will not be able to repay that. But I always feel that as an engineer also, you can contribute, and the quality that I've learned can always be replicated in the civil services. For example, that I've gained many analytical skills. Then the systems approach is energy engineering. In that case, I will in systems approach in energy engineering, you are taught that you should learn to integrate the components and try to see one component impacting the whole system. So I can see things from different perspective, breaking into different components and how one component impact the overall functioning of the system. And then as an energy engineer also, that suppose energy is also used for the women empowerment issues also. For example, there is a project in Rajasthan whereby women have come up and they have formed a cooperative society for solar manufacturing. So this is how also energy can be leveraged for the betterment or in civil services also.
What is your opinion regarding right to privacy as a fundamental right?
Yes, sir, that was initiated and that was confirmed in Ms. Puttaswamy case, and that was a much awaited reform, sir, because it is important for human life, the right to life, for the enjoyment of right to life also, and then right to good life, because that came in the limelight of Article 3, Section 377 of the IPC also, and then in other parameters including all the aspects of life. So I feel that it was a very important move.
Okay, why have concerns been raised over Aadhaar?
Okay, sir. Sir, mainly because the privacy concern, because when you are enrolling and you are taking the biometric fingerprints and the iris scan, in that case, that can be misused if accessed by some other party.
Okay, so you like to play cricket and badminton or watch cricket and badminton?
Sir, I have played cricket at inter-IIT level and played cricket at the hostel level. Badminton at the hostel level.
Okay, can you please explain what is Koplam D?
Sorry, sir.
What is Koplam D?
No, sir, I am not aware.
It is related to famous South African cricketer.
No, sir.
Okay, can you elaborate the present administrative issues with BCCI?
Yes, sir. Sir, it is regarding the transparency of the BCCI, because they are not under the RTI, and because they have huge public money in place, plus the board of directors and the governors. They are all private players and they are not under RTI. So in that case, Mr. Lodha committee recommended that they should come under RTI also.
What is your opinion regarding that?
Sir, I feel that they should be governed under RTI, because they have been involved in the they have raised public money also, and but also secondly they have the monopoly of the game. So if not regulated well, then it can create problems for the these.
But don't you think it will create a hindrance for autonomy of function of BCCI?
Sir, we are not taking all the powers. We are just regulating the thing so that it do not create monopoly and can misuse its power. So it regulation for everybody is important, sir.
Okay. What is your assessment of Donald Trump and his impact on US and for the world?
Sir, Mr. Donald Trump follows the policy of America first. So in that case, he sometimes do things which will only give advantage to US. So in that case, these policies like withdrawing from Paris deal, which whereby they do not acknowledge that climate change is happening and the US can play an important role in mitigating the challenge. Secondly, this withdrawing from the Afghanistan also. In that case, they felt that because many of the soldiers are dying in Afghanistan, so they somehow have started withdrawing and then started the talks with Taliban also, so that the problem can be solved at an earlier basis. But generally, the issue is that plus the protectionism policies, whereby they have imposed fines on the imposed tariff on Chinese products also. So in that case, it is mostly circling about the issue of America First policy, which mostly is having the negative impact on all the prospects of the world.
What do you think about the European integration, and what are the major problems they face these days?
Sir, you are talking in terms of EU? Oh, yeah. Okay, sir. Sir, the issue here is about the Brexit mainly, plus the policy they have not reached to the consensus regarding how much refugees to take in the Mediterranean and in the people who are coming from the Africa also.
Okay,
So these are the two issues that I can think of.
But why is that Germans are willing to take more refugees unlike they say the British?
Sir, I feel that it is about the leadership also, that if the leader has a vision and he is very clear that I want to have more, I want to respect the human rights also. So because this is Angelina Merkel, I feel that she is very tolerant and she has respect, more respect for the human rights. So that is why she is more the Germany, and she is convinced the people that okay, we should take it.
What is your understanding of this Rohingya crisis?
Okay, sir. Rohingyas are the people, Muslim people from Myanmar state, but Myanmar state from 1990s onwards have said that we do not acknowledge them. So in that case, they are the most persecuted religious minority of the world. And then because they have been persecuted by the state of Myanmar, in that case, they have fled to the other countries also. They have been living in the boats in the Indian Ocean part. So that is why they are called boat people also. And then they have shifted to the parts of Bangladesh also, and they have also reached India. So so that is the crisis, that 20 lakh people have been shifted from Myanmar to Bangladesh and India.
So you agree with the India's stand on Rohingya issue?
Sir, personally I do not, but the problem with why India is not taking Rohingya is that there have been some linkages with the terrorist outfits, the attack that have been bought on the Buddhist monastery. So that is why they feel that it is a threat to internal security of India. So in that case, India is supporting Rohingya issue by supporting Bangladesh through Operation Insanita also, and they have also tried to force the Myanmar government by coming together with other countries so that you take your people. So in that case, they are helping, but I feel that if those processes would not work, I feel that India should help the Rohingyas also.
Okay, thanks. We will call you next.